Welcome all again. Good morning, everybody. I hope everyone is fit and fine. So myself, Parik Thru, working in Scope from 5 years, I am basically looking after the several products, the search arrester related all the products, the GIS related all the products, for example, SF6 gas analyzer, SF6 maintenance equipments. I'm also looking after the DC maintenance related all the products like the battery loading units, the battery resistance units, and also I am looking after the circuit breaker maintenance all the products like the Scott CB timer, you know, the circuit breaker operation analyzer. So all these products I am looking after. So what will be the today's agenda is basically we will start from a brief introduction we will get from the LA, then we will briefly discuss about the construction of the surge arrester. Then we will talk about the degradation, what can be the possible reasons because of that my surge arrester health will be degrading. Then we will do the health analysis, how we can periodically check the health monitoring of, do the health analysis of the surge arrester. And then we will talk about the most important thing of the today's webinar, that is the most significant way you can check the healthiness of surge arrester, that is the third harmonic resistive leakage current measurement. Okay, after that we will directly come to our product zone where we'll be explaining the different products, and as per your suitable preferences you can choose those products as per your suitability. And finally, what we will do, that we will have a question and answer session after the presentation. Okay, so this will be our today's agenda. Now, if we are considering the introduction, we all know the bookie's definition of the surge arrester, that it is there at the entry point of the transmission line and it is protecting the expensive equipments like the power transformers, shunt reactors, all these expensive equipments, and ensure safety, and it also protects these expensive equipments from the adverse conditions of the lightning impulses. Now, as you know, right now it is a rainy season, so these adverse conditions of the lightning impulses will come on and on, and surge arrester is one of those equipments in your substation which will protect your expensive equipments. Now, generally, if we are considering the history of the chemistry of surge arrester, that previously what we used as the protection element was the silicon carbide inside the surge arrester. But there was a disadvantage of the silicon carbide, that the protection characteristics of the silicon carbide was less compared to my zinc oxide chemistry, which is used nowadays in the surge arrester. So it is basically nothing but the non-linear impedance material. Okay. But there is a disadvantage of the zinc oxide, that it tends to fail violently compared to the silicon carbide. So it is having its advantages and it also have its disadvantages. Now, if we are talking about the ratings of the surge arrester, we all know that up to 765 kV substation, it is manufactured in India. The rated voltage generally we consider is from the peak phase voltage. Okay, so this is how generally the calculation is going on, 110% of my peak phase voltage. So the peak phase voltage equals to system voltage divided by root 3 into root 2. So this 1.1, which I am multiplying, that is the 110% we are talking about, this 1.1 is called the form factor. So basically, whenever we are calculating the rated voltage, we generally use this formula. But if you go into the substation practically, this rated voltage value will be changed. We have considered this from the nominal voltage of the surge arrester, but generally what we observe, that the rated voltage is calculated from the highest system voltage. So if you are having a 220 kV substation, so many times we can see that the rated voltage has been considered based on the maximum, that is the highest system voltage, considering the highest system voltage. So in that case it will be calculated based on the 245 kV if you are considering 220 kV as the nominal voltage. So if we go into the construction part, so basically what you will see, let me use the pointer here for your better understanding. So this is the top part of my surge arrestor. This is the line terminal. We call this as a line terminal. Then all these mechanical arrangements are here. The flanges are here. The coil springs are here, and the necessary housings are here, which is which is nothing but the supporting structure. Inside my housing, we can generally see the nonlinear ZNO element material is there. Okay, which is the main significant component of a surge arrestor. Now again, this FRP tube and FRP rod, these are all the mechanical parts of this surge arrestor. Next we are having the aluminium spacer also, and you can see here the silica gel we can also see. So basically what the objective of the silica gel is to absorb the moisture content if it is going inside my surge arrestor. So that is why the silica gel is also there. And other than that, all the spacer tube, flanges, these are the all mechanical parts. And the last part we see, that is the base plate of the surge arrestor. Okay, so this is by far the construction of a surge arrestor we talk about. Now, generally, if we overhaul a surge arrestor in substation, generally you can see, you will consider that these zinc oxide blocks are connected in series like this, and it forms a kind of a stack. So these zinc oxide blocks practically looks like this. And one important thing in the construction part is that a surge counter is installed from my base plate through where the ground wire is going to my ground. In between that, a surge counter is installed. Now, a surge counter is generally giving you two parameters, two important parameters. One is the number of surges it has been absorbed. Okay, so that you can see from the surge counter. And the second parameter is the total leakage current in milliampere, it will show you. Okay, but again, I must say in this part that only with the help of the surge counter value, you cannot understand what is the condition of the surge arrestor, because generally what it gives, it is giving the total leakage current, right? So with the only help of total leakage current, we cannot estimate what is the condition of the surge arrestor. Why? That I will come to the next slide. So only with the help of these two parameters, you cannot estimate the value of the health condition of the surge arrestor. Now, generally, what can be the possible reasons for the degradation of surge arrestor? One of the most important point is the lightning impulse. As we all know that each and every surge arrestor is manufactured or designed as per a rated lightning impulse withstand voltage. So if it is going above that value, it may damage your surge arrestor ZNO blocks, or it may damage the overall equipment. Okay, the next part is the entry of moisture. Now we all know that the moisture is one of the biggest enemies of any insulation. Now if we are generally talking about the insulation part, it is only the ZNO part we are talking about, the zinc oxide. So whenever these moistures are going inside these ZNO blocks, what it will do, that it will decrease your effective resistance. Now insulation means you are having a good amount of high electrical resistance, right? But whenever these moistures or the environmental contaminations like the solid microparticles or dust particles, whenever it is going inside these ZNO blocks, there will be a significant decrease in the value of effective resistance. And whenever the effective resistance is decreasing, my insulation is degrading. So generally what we know, that the leakage current value, whichever generally in the manufacturing time, whenever the lighting arrester is quite newly manufactured, the leakage current is very small. But whenever my insulation degradation is happening inside, so my leakage current value will increase. And based on that, there will be a heat loss, that is the I squared R loss will happen inside my ZNO blocks. So one of the most important thing is that the overheating inside my ZNO blocks will increase, which ultimately may lead to an electrical failure if we don't consider it. So that is why we generally need to periodically we can check what is the condition of the AV. So generally, if we talk about an electrical equivalent circuit of a surge arrester, so I have told you that inside my surge arrester, the ZNO blocks are nothing but a nonlinear impedance in nature. So any impedance, if we here talk about, so it is basically nothing but a consisting of capacitance and the resistance, right? So generally, if you see that it is a high voltage source, that is this is the line terminal if you are considering, and this is the base terminal of the surge arrester construction wise. So in between that, here it is my ZNO blocks, this is the nonlinear impedance, and here it is dividing into my capacitive component and resistive component. So initially my value of IT, total leakage current, will be very very small, right? So basically you can understand that my IC plus IR will be very very small, but whenever these unwanted particles or the moisture is going inside, my IT value will continuously increase. Now there is a concept in this total leakage current, as you know, that there is a resistive leakage current plus capacitive leakage current equals to my total leakage current. The capacitive leakage current is generally a constant value here. Okay, the capacitive component will be a constant part, but whenever these unwanted particles and the moisture is going inside my ZNO blocks, my IR value, that is the resistive component of this value, will gradually increase. Now because of that, my I square R loss, that overheating, will happen because of that significant component. So IT, that is whatever the surge counter was giving that particular value, it was giving the IT value, that was the total leakage current, but it was not giving the proper IC and IR value, because IC is not the one, that is the capacitive component, as it is a constant value, it is not the significant parameter in this case. It is always the resistive part of this total leakage current which will gradually increase day by day, year by year, which will generally leads to a electrical failure in the surge arrester. So IR is the significant component here. From the surge counter output, you cannot estimate what is the value of IR. So that is why the surge counter output, that is the total leakage current, is not a significant parameter here, because we need to check the value of resistive leakage current here. Now, if we generally plot these three values in a graph, so we know that voltage and resistive leakage current both are in same phase, right? And if you are considering an ideal condition, so in that case, my resistive component, I mean the capacitive component, capacitive current will lead 90 degree leading from my resistive current. This is the ideal condition, but practically this thing is not happening here. What it does, that basically you will see, whenever my surge arrester is quite new, it is in very healthy condition during the commissioning, I must say, in that case my IR is very very small here. You can see my IC is always constant, as I have said, it has been defined by the IC 600-99-5, that IC is always the constant value. My IC, my IR here, it is quite low for a new surge arrester. So generally, if you do the vector addition here, you will get the total leakage current, that is the IT1, for a new surge arrester. right? Now, whenever that new surge arrestor has been running for around 5 to 10 years, what will happen that significantly because of the aging of the substation, the leakage current, that is the resistive leakage current, will increase because of the entry of the moisture on the unwanted particles. In that case, the significant component, you can see my IR value is now increasing. The IC is always constant here. So whenever we do the vector addition, we get the IT2 new total leakage current. So after aging of the surge arrestor, this is the new total leakage current we can understand. Whenever the condition of the surge arrestor is degrading again and again after quite a few years, so you can see the red zone is coming here. And the IR is quite high in this case, and IC is almost constant. So whenever we are doing the vector addition here, so you can see the IT3, new IT3, it is coming. Now it is in the danger zone. The green zone is in safe zone, the orange zone is in moderate zone, and the IT3, the red zone is in the danger zone. Now, if we plot like this, you can see the IC is always constant. It is not changing. But because of the IR, you can see there's a significant change in IR in all the rest of the two cases, in the orange part and the red line. But what is the value? I mean, what is the significant change in the total leakage current? It is very low. You can see that the value, if we are plotting here, there is a very negligible change in the value. Now, whenever this negligible change we see in the naked eye, in the surge counter value, so you cannot say that what is the danger zone here, because generally what you see is the total leakage current, but you cannot understand that what is the value of the resistive component here. So that is why, the output of a surge counter is like you can say an ambiguous reading. You cannot understand what is the condition of your surge arrestor until and unless you will see there is a significant change in the value of the surge counter. Whenever you see a significant change in the surge counter value, that means the IR value have gone quite high in that case. So your surge arrestor may be in the danger zone. So this is the significance of the IC, IT and IR here. I believe that whatever I tried to convey here, mostly the surge counter values, whatever all the utilities and the end users are referring, that with the help of the surge counter value, we can estimate the health of a surge arrestor, high voltage surge arrestor. The answer is no. You have to check what is the value of IR. So next, if we talk about the health evaluation of a high voltage surge arrestor, so generally what we do in the field is that we generally do mainly two tests. One is the insulation resistance test, that is a high voltage DC, almost around 5 kV or 10 kV DC, high voltage DC we are applying across the surge arrestor, that is from the HV terminal to ground, and we are checking what is the value of the leakage current here. Right, so we are only checking the value of IR in this case, right? Because it is a high voltage DC, the capacitive component is getting ignored here. So you won't understand that you are only getting the IR value here. So this is not a complete picture if we talk about. Again, if you do the tan delta test here, so tan delta test means you are injecting around 10 kV or 12 kV AC across the same connection. That will be my high voltage ground or low voltage to ground. In that case, whatever you will see the leakage current, it will give you the capacitive component, the resistive component, both of these values. But only with these values is it sufficient that you will get the complete picture of the surge arrestor? No, the answer is no. Simply the answer is no, because you are not considering the most important part here. The resistive component of the leakage current is just a part, right? Whatever I have suggested, yes, you see, it is one of the significant component, but not the overall significant component I am talking about. So what will be my significant component that I will come into the next slide? Only the IR and IC will not also give you the complete picture of the surge arrestor health condition. Now, one of the, you can say disadvantages of these two tests are, both of these, you can say, these are offline tests. So surge arrestor has to be taken out of service. It is a time consuming, not the insulation resistance test though, but always the tan delta is, there are a lot of connections and this will be a time consuming test. And sometimes what happens that the equipment unavailability is also a very practical scenario if you are considering this substation testing. So tan delta also is a very costly equipment if you consider. So these are some of the practical scenarios that generally we need to be seen while you are doing the substation testing of the surge arrestor. Now, IEC 60099-5 has significantly said that an effective method to do the health monitoring of the high voltage surge arrestor is that the third harmonic resistive leakage current measure. So from this test only, you can understand that whatever we are generally doing, that we are only checking the value of the resistive current, but we were not considering the harmonics in this case. So harmonics play a pivotal role in this particular case. So how these harmonics will play that pivotal role, then that I'll come next. Now, IEC 60099-5 has given you some of the guidelines here to test the high voltage surge arrestor. Now, you can see from this list that we are having total 8 methods: A1, A2, A3, A4, B1, B2, B3, and C. Now, all these 8 methods we are not using in the field. If you can see in the right part, that what are the options of extensive? The extensive means that it will give you a very good result. It will give you a very high information quality in that test, and it will be feasible in the field practical scenario I am talking about. So if you see the extensive parts here, you can see that the B1 and B2 are the extensive here, right? So this is generally we use these two methods in the air insulated substation. Air insulated substation surge arrestor, we are using these two methods. One is the third harmonic and the other is the third harmonic with compensation. So what are these two methods that I'll explain? And in case of gas insulated substation, where you are not having the lifeline, you are not getting the lifeline. So in that case, what we usually do that we are getting a voltage reference from the PT secondary. And from the PT secondary, we are taking 110 volt as the voltage reference, and we are checking what is the leakage current, because I have already explained that voltage and resistive leakage current both are in same phase. So that is why we are using the voltage reference here. I'll explain the all these tests in a more detailed way when I'll come to the connection part, that how you are actually doing that measurement. So with the help of this, you can understand in field, we are using A1 for GIS surge arrestor and B1 and B2 for the AIS substation surge arrestors. Okay, there is a significant difference between the B1 and B2 method. Now that I am coming right now. Whenever you are doing the testing of surge arrestor, I already said that harmonics is one of the primary components whenever we are doing this test, right? So what are the harmonics? First of all, the harmonics are generally, generated because of the nonlinear loads, right? So in the substation, we can see all the loads maximum are the nonlinear loads here. That is the capacitive loads, I mean inductive loads or capacitive and inductive loads. So all these, because of these nonlinear loads, the harmonics will be generating in the system voltage, right? So there is a part of harmonics in my system voltage. Now in the construction part of the surge arrestor, I have already told you that ZnO, zinc oxide, itself is a nonlinear element. Now because of that nonlinear element, whatever the voltage is generating in the surge arrestor, it is also having some harmonics because of the ZnO itself. So there are two harmonics present in my system. First is the system harmonics because of the nonlinear loads present in the system. The other part is because of the zinc oxide present in the surge arrestor. Because of that, the harmonics are also created. So these two, whenever I am doing the measurement, so these two are adding together, and it will give you the value of those, of the third harmonic resistive leakage current. So whenever we are talking about the B1 and B2 method, I'll come to that part in a more detailed way. So this is the basic concept of the harmonics that I have told you. Just, you know, think from this angle that these harmonics are there, that how I will, you know, compensate my harmonics and all that, I'll come into the next slide. Now, nonlinear voltage and the current characteristics of the surge arrestor is generating the harmonics in the leakage current that I have told you already. Now, out of all those harmonics, the first harmonics, that is the fundamental 50 hertz frequency, is the first harmonics we are talking about. The second harmonics is the 100 hertz. Third harmonic is the 150 hertz. So that is how the harmonics are continuously generating into my system voltage. Out of all these harmonics, we have observed that the third harmonic is the most significant component here. And because of that third harmonic, generally whatever is happening, that my overheating in the ZnO blocks is happening inside. Because of that significant third harmonic component, my insulation degradation is happening. So it is one of the most significant component if we are talking about the leakage current analysis. So it is used as an indicator for computing the resistive leakage current and further diagnosis. Now ICE 600099-5 has suggested that it has recommended that out of all the total resistive leakage current, 10% to 40% of the third harmonic component can be present in the surge arrestor. Now, 10% to 40%, it is a range. It doesn't give you a fixed value. Why it is not giving a fixed value? Because of these four reasons. Okay. One of the most important part is the manufacturing design. Second is the ambient condition or the ambient temperature. The ambient temperature is one of the most important things, because you know that the resistive leakage current or the resistance, it is directly proportional to the temperature. So based on that, if my temperature is increasing, you can understand that maybe there is a significant rise in the resistive leakage current, and based on that, the third harmonic component will also rise. The third is the arrestor rating and the applied voltage. So all these four conditions are there. Because of that, the third harmonic component will be in between my 10% to 40% of the total resistive leakage current. Now, what is IR corrected? But if whenever you are checking the resistive leakage current, there is a main important parameter is the IR corrected. The IR corrected is SA30I generally measures the total leakage current and then calculates the third harmonic current from the resistive leakage current value. Now, this third harmonic current is measured at the ambient temperature and system voltage. With respect to the system voltage at the time of testing, the leakage current will expect to vary based on the system voltage and ambient temperature. Now, as you know that in the different places, we are having a different ambient temperature, right? So whenever it is also, it doesn't depend on the places. It also depends upon the weather. If it is summer, then the temperature will be quite high. And also if it is a winter season, so in that case, my temperature will be quite low, the ambient temperature. So in that case, how you will understand, I mean, I have already said that the resistive leakage current will vary with respect to temperature. So in the same surge arrestor, if you are testing in summer and in winter, it will give you a different value, right? So the trending of those results will not be accurate. So that is why IEC has suggested that in whatever temperature, what will be the ambient temperature, you need to convert it in 20 degree centigrade. Okay, so this is one part. We are also calling it as the temperature correction factor. So for example, I'm in Pune itself, so it is around, you can say the temperature is almost 26 degree. So you need to, whenever we are doing the test, so it needs to be converted into 20 degree centigrade. And whenever you are doing the conversion of this 20 degree centigrade, it is more accurate trending what you will get, because every time you will do the conversion in 20 degree centigrade, and it will give you an accurate trend. Also, the system voltage to the LS rated voltage, because we know that the voltage may fluctuate in some times. So what generally we do, that we calculate the LA rated voltage and we divide the rated voltage to my system voltage, there will be a constant factor. That's the 0.7, whatever we are using here. You need to multiply my IR, that is the resistive leakage current at ambient temperature, into my voltage correction factor, multiplying by temperature correction factor. So this is how you are getting the IR corrected factor. Okay. So again, I am saying IR corrected equals to IR at ambient temperature into voltage correction factor into temperature correction factor. That is how you are getting the IR. And that is how you can do the accurate trend analysis of your surge arrestor. Now, if you are talking about our instrument, that these IEC standard conversion factors are pre-programmed in the instrument. So you don't need to worry about, these temperature correction factor and the voltage correction factor. So if we come into the models of the SA series, the first is the SA10i, second is the SA30i, and third one is the SA30i plus. So SA10i generally measures the third harmonic leakage current without the system harmonic compensation. So without the system harmonic compensation means it is doing the test as per the B1 method, right? The SA30i measures THRC with system harmonic compensation, that means in B2 method, and correction at rated voltage and temperature. So all these conversion factors are pre-programmed in all these three instruments. Now the basic difference of SA30i and SA30i plus is that the SA30i is a wired instrument where you need to physically connect the wires, and in case of SA30i plus, all the accessories, that is a CD and field probe, are wireless. So this is just the basic difference of these two instruments, and there are no in such differences between the SA30i and SA30i plus. Mostly they are same, only the connection part. It is the wired, and the second one is wireless. Now, if you are talking about the online health evaluation of surge arrestor, so I have already told you during the conventional test method, whatever you used to do, that is the insulation resistance or tan delta, all those were offline tests. But whenever you are doing the third harmonic resistive leakage current, that it is an online test, so no outage is required in this case. We are confirming all the ICs, IC 600-99-5, what they have suggested. All these three methods we have implemented in this instrument. So method B1 is the third order harmonic analysis of leakage current. B2 is the third order harmonic analysis with compensation for the harmonics in the system voltage, and A1 is the voltage peak method. So here I'll explain what is the difference between the B1 method and the B2 method, right? Now, the B1 method is you are using the third order harmonic analysis of leakage current. So whenever you are doing this particular measurement, so previously what I have told you that in the system, there will be a harmonics because of the nonlinear loads present in the system. And another harmonics will be created because of the nonlinear ZnO, zinc oxide element. So these two, it will add together in the B1 method. In case of B2 method, what is happening that we are compensating the system harmonics. This is very important. Compensation of system harmonics means whenever we are doing the health evaluation of surge arrestor, we will only consider what is the harmonics present in the surge arrestor, not in my system voltage. Because in the system, there will be harmonics all time it will create because of the nonlinear loads. We will not concentrate on the system harmonics. So what we will do with the help of the field probe, you can see it here. There are two accessories. One is the CT and one is the field probe. During the connection part, I will tell you how it is doing the compensation of the system harmonics here. So whatever we are getting that out of those two harmonics, we are compensating the system harmonics and we are getting the necessary harmonics, which is there itself in the surge arrestor. And because of that, we are not having the inaccuracy in the measurement, because whenever the system harmonics will come in the measurement, it will create nothing but an inaccuracy, because we are not concentrating on the system, we are only concentrating on the surge arrestor, right? So that is why the system harmonic compensation is very, very necessary. So the basic difference I have, I think you have got it. That is, the without system compensation, it is the B1 method, and with system compensation is the B2 method. So all both of these B1 and B2 method is only applicable for the air insulated substation surge arrestors, right? Because you are having the live line. But in case of gas insulated substation, you are not getting the live line. So whatever we are doing, I have told you, we are taking the 110 volt reference from the PT secondary and we are checking what is the value of the IR. So voltage peak method, the voltage peak method itself says the measurement technology. So whenever, as both are in same phase, my voltage and resistive component, so whenever my voltage will be at its peak, I'll get the peak value of IR itself, resistive leakage current. So that is how we are checking the resistive leakage component from the voltage peak method. Okay, but this is very important. I have mentioned it as an optional, because generally what we do, that we give this B2 method as a standard measurement technology, but in case of voltage peak method, we are giving it as an optional method. And whenever some customers who are having the GIS, in that case we are suggesting that you use this particular method. Okay. Also, it is very important that you can get all these three features combined in the same instrument. But in case of placing the order, you need to confirm from your end that we need the voltage peak method. Then only we will implement this in our instrument. Now, the measurement of the total leakage current is done by a very specialized current clamp, which you can see here. In the connection part, I will show you how we'll do the connection of the current clamp. So this is my current clamp and this is the field probe and this is my main instrument. Okay, so this is the different main instrument, where you can see this is my mains input here, this is the socket, this is the on off switch. Here we are also having an inbuilt thermal printer, so whatever the result you are getting, you can directly print it out from this thermal printer. The main unit, power on switch is there. For the communication purpose, we are having this USB port for the PC communication or laptop. Here we are having the temperature sensor. This is an inbuilt, platinum resistance thermometer we are using here. That is the PT100 sensor. Through that sensor, it will automatically calculate what is the temperature, ambient temperature. So this is how we are, you know, getting the ambient temperature well. And next is my display here. That is the 4-line 20 character display we are giving here. We are giving you a 5-key keypad here for the necessary, you know, switching of the menus and all of the settings also. Other than that, you can see the necessary, you know, LED blinkings and all, and you know, the antenna connection. Antenna is nothing but whenever we are using the SA38 plus. So in that case, it will be a wireless unit. So my main instrument, it will be equipped with an antenna here, and the other two accessories, that is the CT and field probe also, it will be equipped with an antenna, and you know, through the same frequency, it will connect each other. It will sync each other. And this is, you know, the overall of the main instrument here. And not to forget, the most important part is the master arcing here. This is the most basic connection of any instrument for the safety of the user as well as the equipment. Now, these are the two main accessories I was talking about. One is the CT unit, and the next one is the field probe unit, right? Now, what is the, what CT unit is doing? CT unit is generally calculating what is the total leakage current, and then generally, you know, it converts into the third harmonic component. It generally calculates the third harmonic of the total leakage current. And field probe is a dedicated unit which generally does the system harmonic compensation. So with a you know, FRP rod here, we will mount this field probe unit to the at the base of the surge arrestor terminal. And what it generally does, that it generally extracts the system voltage, and it generally what does the compensation of the system harmonics, right? So these are the two units through which the measurement is happening. It will be more clear when I'll come to the connection part. So this is the technical specification of all my three instruments. So you can see in the SA30i plus, we are having a very high range, up to 20 milliampere. We are checking the total leakage current as well as the resistive leakage current value. And the other two was having up to 10 milliampere, which is sufficient enough. The resolution, you can see, it is very small, up to 1 microampere, it can do the measurement. So the accuracy of the CT is quite high. The compensation in this case, SA30i plus and SA30i both, what does the noise cancellation? It does the automatic noise cancellation. It does the system voltage correction that I have already told you, the system harmonic compensation that I have already told you, and also the temperature correction. That means from the ambient temperature, it will convert it to 20 degree centigrade as per the IC. And in case of SA10i, generally what it does, that it does the third harmonic resistive leakage current in Bion method. So it doesn't do the system harmonics here. And SA10i is generally recommended for the low voltage customers, low voltage surge arrestor, where the harmonics component is quite low. But if you're having a high voltage substation, for example, 132 kV, 220 kV, or 400 kV, up to 765 kV, I'll recommend that you use either SA30i or SA30i plus. Mostly SA30i plus, the connection is more easy, and it is more effective because it is having a wireless connection here. It is having the inbuilt self-calibration check. The temperature sensor, I have already told you that it is having an inbuilt PT100 sensor through which it calculates the ambient temperature. It is having the self-calibration check facility with the inbuilt source available. It is having an inbuilt memory storage, and it is equipped with an inbuilt thermal printer also, right? And we are having a rechargeable battery, so you don't need to worry about the battery life here. But I'll recommend that whenever you have bought this instrument, you do the regular charging and discharging in a month. So this is a a kind of a maintenance part, or you can say you need to do this because you need to keep not only your search register healthy, but also you need to keep your test equipment healthy. So that is why the battery life is very important in these cases. And you can see by the weight that it is a very portable and lightweight instrument. It is very easy to carry this equipment into the substation and do the testing. Now, whenever I'll come to the connection part, I must say that this instrument is a online instrument, and we are doing the test while the LA is online. So we have to do some precautions in this case, right? So see, this is in case of if a high voltage AIS substation, say air insulated substations. So this will be my surge arrestor. You can see here. So we are considering as the wireless instrument here. We have taken the example of wireless instrument. So it's a 30A plus will be the model. It is my main instrument, and these are the two accessories I have told you, CT and field probe. Now, where you will connect the CT, you can see the ground where it is coming from my base terminal and directly going to my surge counter, and it is going to the earth. So you will connect the CT unit just before the surge counter. Now, what it does, this CT unit will calculate the total leakage current, and with the help of that input, it will calculate the third harmonic component of that total leakage current. Now, the other part is the field probe unit. I have already told you the application of the field probe, that it is a dedicated unit for the system harmonic compensation. So you can see the FRP rod, it is there. You will connect it, the field probe in that rod, and we are just keeping it at the base of the surge arrestor. Okay, do not touch this field probe unit to the live part of the LA. It is very much recommended, because the rod is a insulating rod. You will not get any type of shocks, but the field probe may get damaged, right? So do not connect it into the direct live line part. You just need to keep it here in the field probe. So what it does, that this is a high voltage part, right? And my field probe, what it does from the basic capacitance rule, that from my high voltage to low voltage, the leakage current input, it will directly come to my field probe unit, and this is in that input there will be the system harmonics present, because it is directly coming to my system. The input is directly coming from the system, so the system harmonics will be present here, and the field probe, what will it will do, that it will do the necessary compensation of the system harmonics, and whatever you will get the value here, it will only give you the the harmonics present in the surge arrestor. So that is how you are getting the accurate measurement. So this method, we are calling it as the V2 method, with the help of field probe. Whenever you are not using the field probe here, we will call it as the V1 method, because we are also considering the system harmonics in that case. I hope it is clear now, more clear, because generally what it does, that what I am theoretically saying, maybe it will be much more clearer when I'm coming to the connection part. So I hope now the difference between the V1 method and the V2 method is more clear to you, right? Now, if you are considering it for the GIS-LA, though GIS-LA doesn't look like this, but think for a moment that it is a GIS surge arrestor. So what we will generally do, that we will connect it to the CT unit into the ground wire, like same as that of AIS LA, and my reference input voltage, this I will connect it to my PT secondary, right? The PT secondary is having a 110 volt output, so I'll get that voltage, 110 volt reference from the PT, and what it generally does that it will give you the peak value of the voltage, and with the help of the peak value, we can say what is the value of the resistive leakage current, because the peak value will also give you the peak value of the resistive leakage current. Okay, so this is how, with the help of voltage peak method, you can test the surge arrestor in case of GIS surge arrestor. Now, when for the railways, where the surge arrestor is a standalone equipment, so it is, if it is a standalone equipment, you can say that it is a offline unit, right? Because we haven't energized that ALE. But as you know, that I have told you that it is an online measurement. So in that case, for a standalone surge arrestor, you need to energize the ALE first, because it is an online test. So whenever it will energize the ALE is online. So for example, I have taken that it is a 40 kV surge arrestor. Okay. Now, with the help of our high pot unit, which is a 40 kV high pot, HPT40A. Now, there are two units. One is the control unit and one is the high voltage unit, right? From which the 40 kV 40 kV voltage is directly going to my surge arrestor. Now, the ALE is energized with the help of this HV unit. You can see the connection here. The connection, I don't think it is, it doesn't need to be explained. It is a self-explanatory part. And we are getting the 110 volt reference, right? Because ALE is offline. I mean, ALE we are energizing externally from high pot. So we are not getting the voltage reference. So what I will get that from the control unit, I will get the 110 volt reference here. And I'll connect my CT unit here. And with the help of the voltage peak method again, because we are getting the 110 volt from the control unit here, instead of GIS where you are getting from the PT secondary, we were checking what is the value of the resistive leakage current here. Okay. Again, we have taken the example of SA30i plus here, which is the wireless instrument. So in case of standalone ALE, again, I'm repeating that first you need to energize the ALE with the help of the high pot, that is the HPT40A. We're having two units here. One is the HV unit through which my 40 kV is output is going to my ALE. My ALE has energized. After that, the control unit from which the 110 volt, we are getting the reference and we are directly connecting to my CT here, and we are connecting the CT to the earth here to check what is the leakage current, what is the resistive leakage current. So what is the resistive leakage current? Okay, so with the help of again voltage peak method, we can do this test. Okay, so both in case of whenever this ALE is online and the ALE is offline, both these cases are covered, right? So how you will do the test now, it is I think more clear to you. Now, how to identify the faulty arrestor key? I think this is one of the important questions considering the end user here, because generally what it does that the end user has to understand that whether the arrestor is faulty or whether the arrestor is healthy. This is a very significant part from the end user perspective. So the direct value of the third harmonic resistive leakage current cannot say whether the ALE is all right or faulty. The user has to periodically test the surge arrestor for the third harmonic value and see the trend of the results. For example, I'll say that in my substation, if it is a 220 kV AIS surge arrestor, so for example, I'll check today what is the value of the third harmonic resistive leakage current. For example, it has come around 10 microampere. Okay, So after 6 months, I'm checking again. I'll see that it has been, it has been around 15 microampere. Okay. So in these 6 months, 5 microampere has been increased. Again, after 6 months, you will check and it may come around, 20, for example, let's say 20 microampere. So after 6 months again, you will see that the 5 microampere has been increased. So you can see from these three results how I am understanding that first it was 10 microampere, right? After 6 months, the value was 15 microampere, so the reference is 5 microampere. Again, after 6 months, so again, what the value is 20 microampere, so again, it is increased in 5 microampere. So the rising of my THRC value is 5 microampere. It is a constant one, so it is linearly rising. Okay. Generally, the picture is that it will always increase the value, right? It is not possible that your THRC value will decrease until and unless you are installing a new search arrestor. By the time, by the aging of substation, the value will continuously increase, but my explanation here is that whatever the rise of the THRC, it is a constant value, so it is linearly rising. So in that case, you don't need to worry about it until and unless it crosses a certain value, because it is rising linearly. But in some cases, if you see that the rising of the curve of the IR, or you can say the third harmonic resistive leakage current, it is gradually increasing exponentially. In that case, you can understand that the overheating happening inside the ZNO blocks is quite high, and because of that, the leakage current, the total leakage current, it is rising quite high. And total leakage current, if it is rising quite high, that means your resistive leakage current is increasing a very, I can say it is gradually increasing in a very higher order. So that is how you do the trend analysis of the third harmonic resistive leakage current value. This is, I have given you a example, practical example, that you can understand from an end user point of view. You will check how my THRC value of LA is continuously rising. It will rise. You need to see the trend, that it is it linear or is it exponential, like that. So again, once the arrestor becomes faulty, the third harmonic value starts increasing rapidly. Okay, start increasing rapidly means I am invisibly, the time is always there. I am talking with respect to the time. Okay. Increasing rapidly means, again, it is increasing exponentially, because in x-axis, the time is always there. In y-axis, you put the resistive current, leakage current. And you can see that whether my graph is linear or exponential. So that trend analysis, it can be done in our instrument. And with the help of that trend analysis, you can understand what is the condition of your LA. Okay. So if you understand that your LA value is increasing quite rapidly, you test the arrestor more frequently. So I'll suggest that if you are doing the test, in between a 6 months, I'll suggest that you come down to 3 months. You check the trend on the basis of 3 months. After 3 months, you check again and again, see the trend, and you will generally understand with the help of the value that how it is rising. Now, if the value is rising very fast, LA can be taken out for maintenance. But again, my answer is that you need to consult it with the OEM of the search arrestor first before taking it out for the maintenance. Now, there are a limit which has been defined that that this should be a limit of the third harmonic values. Generally, the value of the third harmonic, I mean the limits of the third harmonic value, depends upon the make and model of the surge arrestor, mainly the design part, right? Who is the OEM of that particular surge arrestor, or what is the voltage level of the surge arrestor? So these are the most important things, because whenever you don't understand that whether my LA is faulty or not, the best person to specify the limits of your surge arrestor is the LA manufacturer only. The one and only LA manufacturer you can consult. Other than that, in absence of those limits, you can follow this particular value whatever I have given here. That is, the if it is crossing 150 microampere, if the third harmonic resistive leakage current value is crossing 150 microampere, then you can do the close monitoring of the surge arrestor. That means you need to test more frequently of the LA. And if it is going beyond 350 microampere, then you can decide to take it out for maintenance. But again, I'll say that before you do this, you consult with the LA manufacturer if he is available. Okay, so these are the some guidelines we can follow. And also for the railways, I like to add this part for the railways customer. Follow the RDSO guidelines. The RDSO guidelines have said that if it is going beyond 500 microampere, then you can take it out for the maintenance as per the RTSO guidelines. But practically, if you really want to check the proper condition, I'll say again that you consult it with the LA manufacturer first before taking it out for the maintenance. Okay, so these are some limits of the third harmonic values I have told you. You can follow these guidelines. Now, in 2010, I'd like to tell small story regarding our product here. In 2010, our product SA30i, which was launched, and it won the best product prize in the Electrama 2010. And in 2016, we manufactured the wireless surge arrestor tester. And again, in 2016, we got the best product in Electrama 2016. So if you know, from the awards and recognitions itself tells a different story about the accuracy of our instrument or the performance of the instrument in high voltage conditions. So this is where my technical presentation is over. So for any further queries or information, you can feel free to contact regarding the sales or product information. You can mail us to marketing@scopetnm.com. If you're having want any information regarding the after sales related issues, you can mail us to service@scopetnm.com. Regarding any technical queries of the product or the overall equipment, you can mail us at ps@scopetnm.com, and our homepage is www.scopetnm.com. I believe you already know. So thank you once again for attending this webinar. I hope it was fruitful and it was full of informations. And I think right now it is the time that where we will discuss the question and answer.
Haritra, you can refer the sheet which I've shared to you. The questions are all in there.
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, so there are some questions that I would like to take. First is, have you leakages current from OEM of SAFD share with us? Is it difficult to get it from the manufacturers? Sir Rajender Kumar Patel, sir, again, you know, this particular question, but generally, you know, as a end user, it is quite sometimes difficult to, you know, contact the OEM of the surge arresters. But I must suggest that you get the test report first while doing the commissioning of the particular surge arrester. You refer the test report, what has been submitted by the OEM. And in absence of the OEM, I believe you can, you know, get the guidelines, whatever was suggested. Sometimes, yes, it is actually difficult to contact the manufacturers, and sometimes, you know, the response is quite delayed from the OEM itself because they are also busy. And generally, you will get it as an end user. I must say that you can question this to the OEM, but I hope that the OEM answers your question. In absence of the limit values of the OEM, I'll say that you follow that particular guideline, that 150 microampere and 350 microampere. Mr. Vijay Kumar, sir, has asked that our surge counters are in shunt mode with the filter of IC. I really don't understand your question, sir. Can you elaborate? Then it will be more easy for us, because I really don't understand the question here. Okay, again, so Vijay Kumar sir has asked, is there any update for 33 kV LA testing when it is directly earthed without leakage meter arrangements? No, sir. Actually, in this case, all the standards like the IEC or the IEEE are silent regarding the values. And whatever, I mean, as a test equipment manufacturer or as a end user, both of us are in the, you know, same room, you can say, and we don't refer the IEC or IEEE here. And also, we would like to get it that what the LA manufacturers are talking about, because generally the international standards are not talking about these things. But we also, I'm also hopeful that we will likely to get an update regarding this, because generally a common question for all the end users is that voltage wise, for example, 220 kV or 132 kV or 400 kV, what should be the limits of the you know, surge arrester resistive leakage current value? Because overall we have talked about, like, for the HV, but what is the value for the individual voltage levels? These are yet to be defined by the international standards. Okay, Rajender Kumar Patel, sir, in case of GIS surge arrester, if no VTE is available nearby SA, how can you use this kit? In case our GSUT SA is far from GIS substation. Okay, sir, in that case, I mean, I must say that, you know, we are giving a sufficient test lead set length. I believe that if the you can connect it to the VT from your surge arrester in GIS. But if it is not available, in that case, what you generally need to do, that you need to talk with the surge arrester manufacturer. In that case, if it is possible during the maintenance, you can do the offline test, whatever I have suggested, that during the overhauling part, to do the offline testing of LA by energizing the surge arrester with the high pot, and you check what is the value of the leakage current. My only suggestion can be this in that case, because there are no other situations, or there are no other options available. Mr. Vijay Kumar sir again has asked that trending is problem in online testing due to variations in the live harmonics. Yes, actually you are correct, Vijay sir. But if you are using any conventional test kit where it is doing the measurement in the B1 method, right? In the B1 method, if it is using, you are using, then the problem is that the system harmonics will come into that particular measurement and it will give an inaccurate value. That is why I'll suggest that you use the model like our model SA30i or SA30i plus, where the system harmonic compensation is available. So if the system harmonic compensation is available, then there will be no problem of the variations in live part of the harmonics, because the system harmonics will always change, but generally the harmonics in the surge arrestor, because of the Zeno, it will not vary, it will be a constant. So Vijay Kumar said, I was talking about the B2 method. Again, if you are using with the B1 method, in the live part, the harmonics are quite, it will do the variation of the results. So I must say you use the B2 method, which, we always ensure in the specification that you need to use the B2 method, because in the live line, the harmonics values are quite absurd and it will give you an inaccurate a result and you cannot do the trend analysis. So always use the B2 method here. B2 method is the best method for the field testing of AIS substation. So in that case, it will be more easy for you to do the trend analysis. Mr. Dharmendra Yadav sir ask that mainly which type of SA used in 400 or 765 kV SS. Which type of SA if you are talking that will say that the of surge arrestors we are using in the high voltage current and during online testing kit leakage current is not matched. Yes, exactly sir. Whenever you are doing the leakage current, with the help of any instrument, if you are doing the leakage current monitoring test, it is giving you the value of the third harmonic resistive leakage current. And if you are doing with
Aritra, I think Aritra has lost his connection. We will wait for a minute. He will join back through some other connection. By the time, you can try to fill up the feedback form. If the link is available in the chat box, please fill it up so that you can also get the presenter's note at the end of the filling up of the form. So you can download it and keep it for your future reference.
sorry, I got disconnected because of the internet. As of Sunil sir's question, that the third monitor value and the instrument value. So the instrument value is the third harmonic resistive leakage current value, and the kth value is the surge. I mean, the kth value is the third harmonic resistive leakage current value, but the surge monitor value is the value of the total leakage current. And based on that total leakage current, you cannot estimate the condition of the LA, right? So with the help of that, I think most of the questions are covered today. And please fill the feedback form. I think Sanket sir, it has been given, right? The link is already given. Also, I think the presenter's note is also, it is there. After filling the feedback form, you can get the presenter's note. And I must say that after this, I think we will meet at the next month, 7th, the next Saturday itself, where we will be, I'll be the one who will